Good evening. Now I'm on. Good evening. Good evening, everyone. So nice to hear the great conversation and people enjoying their evening, because this is an evening to celebrate and to celebrate a life and a person who has done great things for our field and our community. So my name is Brenda Clement, and I'm Executive Director of CHAPA, Citizens Housing and Planning Association in Boston. I know we've got some Massachusetts people in the crowd, so welcome. I'm very happy to be here also in my capacity as Chair of National Low Income Housing Coalition, and to welcome you all to the celebration of Sheila and the celebration of her life. And we're very, yes. We're very happy that her husband and her family could join her today as well, too, for this celebration. So thank you all for coming and for sharing her with us. We know that the demands of her job many times, I'm sure, late calls or projects that she was working on at home. And we know that that takes in and cuts into family time. And we're glad that you were willing to share her as well. So I have the pleasure of thanking Sheila on behalf of the entire board, and I also want to thank all of the board for being part of our, being a strong process and strong board, and particularly during this time when the board did the most important thing that a board does, and that's run a search process for the next director. And our board really stepped up, and I certainly appreciated the support from all of our board members in that process. I was trying to thank you all. I know many of you are still eating your meal, and please do that. But while you're eating, can you please also give a round of applause to our servers from Local 25? Thank you all for all of your hard work and for making our evening special as well. I was trying to remember how long or when I first met Sheila, and I can't remember when I first met you, Sheila. I think it always felt like you were always there and always advocating for work. And I certainly have learned a great deal from Sheila as board chair. I have the privilege of getting to talk to Sheila on a regular basis and checking in on mostly weekly calls, depending on our crazy schedules, and kind of hearings and bouncing ideas back and forth. And so it really, for me, that's been a very special time, because it's given me a chance to get to know Sheila a little bit more directly as well, too. Anyone who knows an advocate knows, though, that sometimes an advocate, I mean, part of your job is just to make people mad sometimes, and to make people angry at what you're doing, and to keep pushing and pushing and kind of just keep saying, you know, one more thing. And Sheila's been that, for sure. And we all appreciate that. I like to think of people like Sheila like toasted marshmallows. Now, I don't have a marshmallow with me. Unfortunately, I couldn't find one. But a toasted marshmallow, because sometimes, you know, when we're advocates, we're a little crusty on the outside, and we push and pull back at people a little bit more. But inside, it's sweet, soft, gooey marshmallow. And Sheila is that. And because I get to talk to her on a regular basis, I know that her heart is always in what she does and what she advocates for. So will you raise your glass to our toasted marshmallow? And Sheila, thank you for all of the wonderful leadership and work that you've done for our organization for so many years. So the best way that you can help and support a toasted marshmallow is by doing and giving your time and money. We have created as a board the Sheila Crowley Advocacy Fund, which will be used to support some of our funding and activities that we can't use foundation money for and other money for. And so we're off to a wonderful start with our our advocacy fund, and I urge you to consider another special donation as well, or to bring it back to your organization as well, too. Paul assures me that everybody has one on their seat, so please take that with you and make a donation. Any donation in any amount I direct a cherub choir at our church, and one of the songs that they sing is has a lyric to it called "A little is a lot when it's in the right spot." And it's much cuter when you're a 3- and 4-year-old singing it. But in any case, a little bit of your time and effort and money will go a long way to help us advocate for social justice and housing justice for everyone in this country. So, and with that, I have the pleasure of introducing the Honorable Barney Frank. Barney, as all of us know here in the room, is the former U.S. representative from the great state, or Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Mr. Frank represented the 4th Congressional District of Massachusetts for more than 3 decades and chaired the House Financial Service Committee from 2007 to 2011, the golden years from the housing advocacy world community. Throughout his career, Mr. Frank has been an outstanding champion for affordable housing and a great friend of the movement and of NLHC. So I'd invite him to come up for his reflections about Sheila. Thank you.
Thank you. I note that our MC was very precise to make it clear that Massachusetts is a commonwealth and not a state. Very important distinction. People should understand it has absolutely no meaning whatsoever. I have a niece. She was in school in Virginia, which is also a commonwealth, as is Kentucky and Pennsylvania, or as are. And she came home with an assignment, right? She was 10 or 11. And it's nice when younger people think well of you. And I am afraid I greatly disappointed her, because the assignment was to say what was the difference between a state and a commonwealth. And there was absolutely no difference. It is just some purely linguistic conceit. And it's taken me a while to win back her confidence. But I don't do a lot of these these days. I am getting better at retirement. I wasn't good at it at first, but with the encouragement of my husband and my assistant, I don't go out and speak that much. To be honest, I do go speak to groups that pay me, and I don't mean to be partisan, but I will say, and look, the people, you're going to go speak for money. You're going to speak to rich people, because poor people don't have money, and they're smart enough not to give it to you if they did, just to make a speech. But I did tell Hillary Clinton, whom I strongly support, that I did have a problem with her speech fees. They are bigger than mine, and I am very jealous. The only secrets I can tell are kind of domestic. But I make an exception. This is from the time I got to Congress in 1981 and asked Speaker O'Neill to put me on what was then the Committee on Banking and Urban Affairs, I think it was called. And the promotion of rental housing for low-income people has been one of the constant themes in my service. And you know, one of the people, I've always believed that decent rental housing was underappreciated, it was unfairly denigrated, and that in fact it was the best way to house low-income people, as opposed to what later became more popular, which was to encourage poor people to take out mortgages that they were unlikely to be able to sustain. And the part of what fueled that was the denigration of decent rental housing. I try to argue that home was important, not so much home ownership. That was an extra. And it was very frustrating. And we would run into this situation, and I don't know whether it's still the case, but I had colleagues in the 80s and 90s when we talked about decent, affordable rental housing, they got a mental picture of Pruitt-Igoe or Cabrini-Green or Columbia Point. And the fact that we had long since learned, if we had the right flexibility and funding to build housing that was very attractive and desirable, they lost that. And I think we are finally getting to that. And I, although recently, I don't know, I'm sure some of you noticed it, I was appalled to see in the business section of the New York Times a story about how rentals were bad for neighborhoods. It was a front page story in the Times. I was furious about how what you had was some of the housing on which there had been foreclosures. And one of the things I worked very hard to do, along with one of the great advocates for affordable housing in the history of America, and some of you will remember him, Henry B. Gonzalez of Texas, a great man. And when we did the first of the bailouts in the S&L crisis, we put in a requirement that much of the housing that the federal government took over as a result of that had to be made available for low-income people, including for rentals. And we try to do it again with regard to the bailout, although budget rules on the latest crisis made it harder. But there is finally, I believe, an appreciation of this, that building decent rental housing is a much better way for the people involved and for society. And I have to say, people tell little lies. You know, not just politicians. Politicians, the biggest lie, and actually you're seeing it now, the biggest lie, the most frequently uttered lie by politicians, candidates for office is, oh yeah, we ran against each other, but we're good friends. No, you were not. But the other one that applies not just to politicians, but to everybody is, oh, I hate to say, I told you so. Everybody likes to say, I told you so. I have found, I will tell you, I not only like saying, I told you so, it is one of the few pleasures that improves with age. I can say, I told you so without taking a pill before, during, or after I do it. And we told them for decades that rental housing for low-income people was the best way to go. Yes, of course we would like to raise people's incomes. We would like to reduce the number of people in poverty. But the reality was when you have people with little income, particularly in parts of the country where housing is expensive, that decent rental housing is something that we can afford. It is cost efficient, and it is also a very good solution. And we ran into the period, and then of course we ran into the obstacle that, okay, we'll help poor people with housing with a voucher program and no construction. And that was always a dilemma for me. Yes, a voucher program absent any construction funds helps with equity, but it drives up housing costs. It is a bad economic policy to add to the demand for housing in ways that do not increase the supply, particularly when you talk about annual vouchers. No one is going to build housing based on an annual voucher. No one would be allowed to lend to a builder based on an annual voucher. So vouchers without a construction program are a very mixed blessing. And I'm glad to say that we at least have begun to make a start on that. But it's an area where we should be putting a very high priority of putting funds in it. It's also clear we know how to do it. It is efficient. And for my conservative colleagues who worry about government dictation, let's take the best measure of how good a program is, consumer satisfaction. I used to have hearings when I was in charge to point to the waiting lists for many of the best projects. And yeah, you may not think that's good housing, but there are waiting lists of people around the block. We continue to have a problem. And I was pleased to see today a column by Paul Krugman in the Times about housing. He didn't go quite as far as he should, but complaining about excessively restrictive zoning. And I got to say, I served for many years with other politicians, and I was frequently critical of them, and I think the media has been a problem. But we're not going to fully address what we need to address unless we add in one other group that is sometimes a cause of problems. The voters are no bargain either. And one of the serious obstacles to housing, and one of the things that will be, I hope it'll become a more serious obstacle, I hope we'll get more money. And I do believe if this election goes as I believe it will, although I have to say I found myself this last week worried that Donald Trump would collapse before November rather than on Election Day. But I think we have a very good chance next year of having a president and a Senate committed to doing the right thing for unfairness in this society. A House with maybe still Republican control, possibly not, but with members chastened by the results of an election. We have a chance to do the right thing, and I believe, thanks to the work of people here, Sheila foremost among them, we have the infrastructure in place with the cooperation with the state housing authorities and the advocacy groups and everybody else. We have the infrastructure in place. So this is a case where more money could almost immediately translate into better results. And so once we get a new Congress, a new president, that degree of advocacy will be very, very important, and it could be very useful. At that point, we will run into the problem of people in neighborhoods announcing that they can't possibly have poor people living in their areas. And I've encountered that. I'm very proud of the city I live in, Newton, Massachusetts, where there was just an election for the Board of Aldermen, which resulted in a pro-low-income housing development coming in. And I was very pleased on this one because it's going to be put on a parking lot, which is within a half a mile of the home that my sister has that I use when I'm there. So I was able to go and say, yeah, it'll be a problem for me. I want to do it. But we need to gear up. We need to gear up, and people, this is a group of community activists. We need to start working out plans to put pressure on the local communities. And the problem is when housing proposals come up before local boards, only the neighbors show up, because the people who are going to benefit don't know who they are. I continue to advocate a process, totally legal, by which developers of affordable housing, by whatever process they're going to use for tenant selection, pre-select the tenants so that when it goes before the city council or planning board or whoever, those people who will get to live there can show up and lobby to offset the neighbors. And not just the people who are going to live there, but in some cases, their relatives who are going to get them the hell out of the house will be very happy to go and lobby for that housing. So that's the next one. I continue to say we should have tours. My friends from Massachusetts are here. In the city of Boston, some of you have heard me say this before, there is a corner in, it's where the Back Bay, the posh neighborhood of the Back Bay, melds into the South End, which had been a lower-income neighborhood but is now a mixed, somewhat gentrified, but still has low-income people. The argument has been that if you build a development for the poor, a subsidized development for the lower and middle class, it will destroy the neighborhood. It will devalue other housing. Please, next time you're there, go to the corner of Tremont and Arlington Streets in Boston. No, Arlington. I'm talking about L'Atelier. Isn't that Arlington? Yes. The corner of Arlington and Tremont. Used to be in my representative district. And on one side of the street is the Castle Square Housing Project, which was one of the first 221D3s in the country. And in the middle of it is public housing. It's a 221D3 with public housing for the elderly in the middle. Across, and it's been there since the late 60s, across the street, it was an interesting place, by the way. It's sort of at the edge of the South End. When I was running for the legislature and I was there, what I learned was there were a lot of interracial couples there. Because in Massachusetts, in Boston at the time, you will remember, racial harmony was not one of our 87 best things. And if you were an interracial married couple, you had a problem about where to live. Now, if you were wealthy enough, you could move to a town where it was okay. But if you were of a limited income, if you lived in South Boston or in Roxbury, one or the other partner would encounter potential problems, and there was hostility. Castle Square, sort of on the border, became a refuge. It was a low-income place for interracial couples, and I learned a lot from just working there. But here's the point. Across the street from this long-standing, low-income, subsidized housing development is the most expensive private housing in Massachusetts. It is a high-rise condominium called L'Atelier. And you can get condominium, you can get hotel services in L'Atelier. It is an extremely posh place to live. It was built across the street from one of the largest subsidized housing projects in Boston. It was not deterred by its presence. Now, I don't like to over-argue my case. It is literally across the street. It is true that it is a very wide street, I want to be honest. Tremont Street at that point, it's like four lanes with a divider. So maybe whatever bad vibes jump across from a subsidized unit to a luxury one, maybe like three lanes they jump across. But apparently four lanes with a divider blocks the virus. That's something we really have to continue to address. With all that, we are making great progress. One last point I want to make about this, and this is something to build on. Sheila and I were talking about it. For many years, and this is true of a lot of people here, when we argued that it wasn't enough to have overall economic growth, but that we had to pay attention to how that growth was distributed, that it was not true that the rising tide lifts all boats metaphor took care of everything, because the economy is not a tide and people are not boats, and the money was being very unevenly distributed. I guess if you want to stick with the metaphor, it was the body of water involved was kind of a canal with locks, people at different levels. But for years, when we, I mean literally the case, would argue for paying attention to distribution, not simply higher growth, we were told that we were engaging in what? Class warfare. And that was a totem that dissolved all of our arguments. That's class warfare. I wrote a column earlier this year. It was an obituary for class warfare. If you look at this year, and it happened, nobody is now insisting that all we have to look at is growth, no major political figure. Even on the Republican side, because they had a problem. America's overall economic progress has been among the best in the developed world. So how do you run against the president when the economy is doing well overall? Well, you point out that it's not being fairly shared. Great, but that's what the Republicans are doing. The need to critique Obama's economic performance has put every single Republican into the position of arguing that we don't have fair shares. I take it back. I'm not sure that Jeb Bush ever reached that. But on the Democratic side, of course, that is a very strong argument. Here's why I'm optimistic. There is now broad acceptance in America that it is important to look at how the new wealth is distributed. What makes me optimistic is this. How do you argue that there should be a distribution of wealth better than we have, and then oppose any public policy that would bring that about? How do you accompany that with a call for reducing taxes on the rich? How do you oppose the minimum wage? How do you block trying to make higher education more accessible or easing the cost of medical care? The Republican candidates who have used that against Obama have made a short-term calculation. Longer term, it will hate them. There was not a single public policy debate in America where those of us who are on the liberal side don't benefit once there is an acceptance of the need to make changes in distribution. And the death of class warfare will, I think, be seen as one of the as one of the high points. So I am somewhat optimistic about where we go from here. And I always need to mention, let me say this. If you haven't read President Obama's interview in the Atlantic magazine, please do it. It is one of the best public policy statements by a president. And he lays out the case for a substantial reduction in America's self-imposed worldwide military responsibilities, even in cases where we can't do very much good and have no real need to do it, And that allows us to free up the resources. We have the infrastructure in place. I believe there is a political recognition now about inequality needing to be reduced, and decent housing is obviously one of the core things in which you do that. If we can just follow through on that, and in the next, the public to some extent is angry at excessive military involvement. We can build on that. This is one area where there can be a left-right coalition and pull back some. So I believe that the ground could be good for us to move forward. Now, a major reason for some of these gains is Shirley Crowley. I got to say, let me talk about what a good job. Our MC pointed out, you know, that part of the job is to get people mad at you. She is very good at that. Shirley and I have had discussions over the years about issues when I was in my office and she was in hers, when we really didn't need the telephone. I think the volume probably carried. But they were arguments about how best to achieve this thing we were both passionately committed to, and we both learned from them, and we benefited from them. And frankly, our willingness to just, there was a great, you worry when you're arguing with someone, let me be serious, and you're fighting, and you worry about, am I going to damage this relationship? This is a valuable relationship. She was a wonderful woman. Of course you want to continue to be a friend. But the depth of our shared commitment to this issue, our determination to get it done right, gave us a security, because we could then be as vociferous and controverting as we could possibly be about the issues, with no danger that the relationship would even fray, much less shatter, because it was based on this common passion. She is extraordinary. I am a great believer in free speech. I would ban nothing. For instance, I'll give you an example. When we were debating adding lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people to the protection of the hate crimes bill, and all that meant was that if you commit a crime based on the prejudice, then the sentence is enhanced, and it only deals with things that are already criminal. Well, some of the African-American ministers had told their members that they were worried that this hate crimes thing, as they interpret it, might keep them from preaching out of Leviticus and other texts that homosexuality was wrong. Now, the Congressional Black Caucus, people should understand, has been the single strongest demographic group in the House on behalf of LGBT legal equality. The Congressional Black Caucus has a better record on that set of issues than the gay members. Not than the openly gay members. I'll make a distinction. But and I said at a caucus when they raised that issue, I said, please reassure people that this is only something that deals with crimes. Physical crimes, crimes of violence against people, or the destruction of property. It has nothing to do with speech. And I said, I was, remember at that time, chairman of the Financial Services Committee. We were just beginning to deal with the financial crisis. I said, in fact, tell your ministers that if this bill became law tomorrow, it would still be perfectly legal to call me a fag. I just wouldn't recommend it to anybody in the banking business. So I would not ban most speech. But if I was going to do it, I would make it illegal to talk about pragmatism and idealism as if they were opposite approaches. They are not by a long shot. You need both. It's not a chicken and egg situation. You start with the idealism. You have no business trying to make laws that coerce other people unless it's out of a genuine understanding that this will make things better for their quality of life as well as others. But once you are committed to a set of ideals, you are morally obligated to try to get them achieved. Idealism without pragmatism is a pose. It makes you feel better, but it doesn't accomplish anything. It doesn't house a homeless person, clean up a river, get medical care to an older woman who needs it. And that's why Shirley is someone I have cherished, because unfortunately, there is a tendency to use these in opposition, and for some to say, well, I can't make that comment. You're a pragmatist. I'm an idealist, meaning I just want to feel good by being talking about how moral I am. I'm not going to pay any attention to whether it gets done. And you know what? Idealism is easy. There is nothing more comforting than purity. I once said, we were talking about Ralph Nader, he was critiquing something we were trying to get done. I think it was the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, and I just burst out, Ralph, you are luxuriating in the purity of your irrelevance. The point is that Sheila has been willing to do the hardest part of the job. Frankly, figuring out what to do intellectually is often the easier part, except in this case, it required her knowledge, obviously, of the substance of housing policy, as good as anybody I've ever met, better than almost anybody else. A full understanding of the legislative process, complicated as it is, and an excellent grasp of politics and of community. And she had all three of those. So with those three bodies of expertise that are not always combined in one individual, she was able to understand what was the best way to go. But then came the hard part. The hardest part is persuading your friends and your allies and the people you cherish and the people you care so much about and your comrades in arms that, no, we can't get everything, but this is the best we can do, and getting it is worth doing. You know what? People talk about, I stand up to my enemies. Next time a politician brags about standing up to her enemies, blow her off. You know what you get from standing up to your enemies? Campaign contributions from your friends. The hardest thing in politics is differing with your friends. It's going to people with whom you share those deep, motivating passions and explaining that this is the best we can do. It is a tribute to Sheila's genuineness and skill that she was always willing to do that and do it successfully and maintain the support. And I am grateful to the people here for giving her that kind of support that allowed her to do that. So I am very pleased to be here tonight. And I mean, I say that more often than I mean it, to be honest. towards the end of my career, when I felt pretty secure, it may have been after I decided I wasn't going to run again, I did say at a couple of dinners, well, I do want to say that I am here in person, but I cannot be with you in spirit, which people feel more often than they say. But I didn't want to miss this one. This is a wonderful occasion, not just Sheila, but all these people. You are a group, you are individuals who have worked very hard for the most important and underappreciated social program in America. I don't know why it is, maybe it's not glamorous enough, housing gets so little attention, but you know, I'm gonna go on too long, but just make the point that you all know. It makes no sense to complain about the education that poor children receive and ignore the role that inadequate housing plays in what that does to them. It makes not much more sense to extend programs to keep children healthy and then condemn them to live either homeless or in substandard housing conditions. So you work on one of the core values that we have to improve to be the decent society we want to be. And Sheila has been the exemplar of how to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Frank. We appreciate your kind comments about the work, but also particularly about our Sheila as well. And Mr. Frank has agreed to take a few questions. So if anyone has a comment or a question, and I will remind you about Sheila's rule about it has to really be a question. There's some mics going around. Now I believe there's one over here, one over there.
It's all right.
No questions?
Not mandatory. Good. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, nope. Sorry. Do we got a question? No? I guess scratching head. Nope. I guess it's a crowd. You said all that needed to be said. So thank you. Oh, but hold on. Hold on. From your former constituent in Massachusetts.
So. And thank you. And I'm actually going to ask this question with a very specific Massachusetts lens. We are so incredibly grateful for the delegation that we send to Washington every year. And I so my question is because I'm hearing myself back here, is how do we in Massachusetts and in other states that do send very competent delegations down here to D.C., how do we play a bigger role in convincing the rest of the nation to get on board with what we know is good and what works?
Well, first of all, as good as my former colleagues are, don't take it all for granted. There is still, I will tell you, in the back of some of their minds, Columbia Point and through what I go, you know, to ask every one of them, not just in Massachusetts, take them to some of the newer developments that have been built, including the public housing. They really need the physical counter. And secondly, remind them that extra military spending bites into it. Beyond that, what you do is you ask your people to call their friends and relatives in their own areas and talk to them. You get people to talk to, you know, there are elderly people living in housing. They have children elsewhere in the country and vice versa. That you get out your... When an important piece of legislation is going up, get out your Christmas card list, your holiday card list, and write to everybody and say, would you please call your representative and senators and tell them to vote for this bill? That would be a useful thing. Thank you all.
Thank you all. And now it's your turn to get to make some comments or... rebuttals, I guess, about Sheila, whichever you'd like. But before I open it up to the floor, I would like to ask a fellow board member and colleague Martha from Tennessee to come up because I believe you have a special presentation. Where are you, Martha? There you are. Please join us. And I think we'd like Sheila to come up for this too, right?
Hey, 1 minute. Sheila Crowley, the State of Tennessee House of Representatives, House Joint Resolution number 503 by Representative Joe Pitt. Whereas it is appropriate that the member of this legislation body should honor those citizens who have performed with uncommon devotion and enthusiasm through their years of public service. And whereas President and Chief Executive Officer of the National Low Income Housing Coalition, Dr. Sheila Crowley, is one such estimable person who has announced she will be taking a much-deserved retirement in April 2016 after leading the organization for more than 17 years. And whereas during her time at the helm of NLHC, Dr. Crowley achieved a number of victories for the affordable housing crisis. Her determined advocacy led to the creation of the National Housing Trust Fund, which was designed to build, preserve, rehabilitate, and operate rental homes for the people with the lowest income as part of the Housing Economic Recovery Act in 2008. Whereas, be it resolved by the House of Representatives of the 109th General Assembly of the State of Tennessee, the Senate concurring that we extend to Dr. Sheila Crowley our heartfelt wishes for a happy and fulfilling retirement and every continued success in her future endeavors, adopted February 1st, 2016, signed by Representative Joe Pitts, Speaker of the House, Representative Beth Harwell, Speaker of the Senate, Ron Ramsey, and Honorable Governor Bill Hassan.
So you got four copies, man.
I told you that Martha has juice, right? Martha really makes things happen. That's great. Thank you.
Thank you, Martha. Okay, as I said, we have some roving mics going around, and I would open it up to the floor for anyone who would like to share a comment or personal story about Sheila. Keep it clean. It's a family act, okay? All right, Bill, somebody's calling you out. Who would like to start? Who's going first?
I am asking you to give the mic to Bill.
Bill, you ready to reeling to go?
Yeah.
You've been nominated.
I'm ill prepared. I would just say I've been with Sheila for these 17 years, and I'm leaving too. No. And what Barney said is absolutely true. Sheila challenged her friends to continue this fight in the face of massive opposition and inertia at the federal level, when a lot of us would rather go do something else. And it was her persistence and conviction that really carried the day. Yep. So it's been proud. I've been proud to serve with you. And I'll come visit you at the water.
Anyone else? Joy?
All right, Joy. Come on, baby. Say something better than I did.
Sheila, I actually knew Sheila's husband before I met Sheila. And so I had a working relationship with him. And then because of the, I don't know if you all remember the national public housing campaign. And I got involved with that. And then I got to meet Sheila. Sheila and I never always agree. But over a drink of Ray, we could talk about a whole lot of things, which is Tanqueray. And a lot of the public housing residents on I served on the National Low Income Coalition Board for 9.5 years, I think it is. And through that, you know, there were some qualities I would see with Sheila when I'm drinking Ray, but there were some other qualities I saw with Sheila when I wasn't drinking Ray. And so what I understood was that I had to listen, and I had to learn, and sometimes we had to compromise or figure out, okay, what is our give? But the one thing that she knew, and even with Cushion DeBaer, she knew that we was going to stand firm, and so she would always try to find a corner or always find where we were huddled, to be able to implant herself to say, I still want to understand. And so what I have learned, that is a key to being able to understand people. And so for that, Sheila, I want to say thank you. Good luck. And what are you going to be doing next other than your great kids? But thank you. Thank you, Sheila, and thank you for inviting me. Even when I'm off the board, she invited me back, and I just want to say thank you for that.
Thanks. Thanks, Daisy.
Sheila, I am very thankful and grateful for meeting a person like you. Before I came on the board, you were there, and you were the face of the National Low-Income Housing Coalition. Serving on the board and seeing you at work showed me a person who stayed to the mission and always looked out for the low-income resident. Always looked out for the low-income residents. And perseverance. When everybody else was ready to quit, you just rolled your sleeves up and found another way with your staff to become creative and get that message across. And I just want to thank you for your leadership. I want to thank you for who you are. to the National Equal Housing Coalition and to me.
Thank you, Daisy. Right back there, Michael, and then I see Matt.
I have been representing North Dakota as one of the state partners of the National Low Income Housing Coalition for 5 years now. And it has been a tremendous 5 years coming down to these conferences and learning so much from so many of you, but particularly learning so much from Sheila. Sheila has made a huge impact on the national level that we are all aware of. But I believe this is a case where trickle down actually works, because her example has been followed in many, many states, including my state, and has had a tremendous impact. So Sheila, to the extent that I've been able to model my activities and that my organization's activities after what you have accomplished, you have contributed greatly to our success, and you have my eternal gratitude.
Sheila. I met Sheila in, I think it was about 2008, 2009, at the Plymouth Congregational Church in my neighborhood in South Minneapolis. She was talking about housing issues. I was introduced to her by Barb Harris, of course. I was president at the time of the tenant organization. She impressed me. Her knowledge is impeccable. The love, the compassion, the caring, the understanding of extremely low-income people just impressed me beyond words, and is impeccable in how much she loves extremely low-income people, residents, whoever is really deserving of affordable housing, which everybody in this country, as rich as this country is, deserves affordable housing, and everybody deserves a housing. But a year later, I come back, Ms. Harris asked me, and I talked to Sheila again, well, we need another representative from Minnesota to be on our board. And here, Sheila Crowley, her staff, I think Chip just got done with his term, Chip Hallbeck just got done with his term, and they asked me to be on this board. I was shocked, I was honored, I was grateful. You have taught me so much over the last 5 or 6 years. It is tremendous. All the information you have given me, all the help that your staff has provided, not just to me, but all the residents of Minneapolis, is impeccable. I've had some of the hardest times in my life in the last 5 or 6 years of family loss and politics, and I'm not gonna go on all that. But she's always been there to support me. She's given me breaks, I think sometimes, even probably when I don't deserve them. But she's always been there to encourage me, the hugs, the love, the calls, to even come and talk to me personally to make sure that I was all right. It was impressive, and she wanted me to keep coming back. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart. You inspired me, and you inspired everybody, all the residents that are on your board, and all the residents that deserve public housing or Section 8 housing or choice housing throughout this country. Without people like you and Diane Yentzel, we would be in big trouble. And representatives like Barney Frank that fight for low-income people throughout the country, there would be too many and more homeless people in this country than we could ever not want. 7 million is too many as it is now. There should be zero, as far as I'm concerned. And people like you are the reason why there is affordable housing, and I thank you.
Thank you, Matt, for those heartfelt comments. I think we have somebody, where are you going? Okay, we have somebody right over here, Ed, and then I'll get Dolores next.
Sheila, I've spent my first year of graduate school in law school, and then I realized the error of my ways and became a social worker. I wanted to be a social worker because I really thought you could do noble things. You are the most noble human being I have ever known. And I am so grateful that even though I haven't known you nearly as long as all the people in the room, that I have had the last 2 years to be under your aura, as it were, or whatever. And I've just, you are the most noble human being I've ever known.
Thank you. Yep, Dolores.
Sheila, I don't think you remember where you met me at. You met me in Chicago at a conference. I didn't want to go to the conference, but after I got there, I was really glad I went. I got to talk to Sheila, and we talked about the board. I went home. I forgot about the board. I got this call from Sheila. Would you like to be on the board? I couldn't say no. But sometimes I think she wish I had said no. Because
are you a toasted marshmallow too?
Yeah. Because I know she got tired of hearing, I live in public housing. I'm a public housing resident. So every time she would introduce me, she said, that's Dolores, that's the public housing resident. But I love you, we'll miss you, and I've already told Diane she's gonna get the same thing. I'm public housing.
We have one right there, and then Paul, I'll get to you. Yep, we got lots of hands now, hold on.
Hey, Sheila.
We're gonna have time for a few more, so before we let Miss Sheila come up to say a few comments, go ahead, please.
Hey, Sheila. I'm LaShady, I'm from McKinney Housing Authority, thank you. You guys probably know who I am by now, and that's all thanks to Sheila. So we thank you for the opportunity to be among all these leaders and activists and advocates. And we wanted to leave you with something special so you don't know why I'm really here. And I'll tell you why I'm really here. You ready? How do I say goodbye to what we had? Good times that made a laugh, I'll wave them back. Hey, I thought we cared to see forever, but forever's gone away. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday.
The rock star when we had Castro here, but I don't know. Thank you. Anyway, we got time. Paul. Sing, Paul.
I have to go after that. So we have, somebody had to say something from the staff. As Sheila knows, we have a bunch of introverts on the staff. So somebody had to stand up and say something. A couple of things. One, I worked in affordable housing, community development, an organization that was much more broadly focused than NLIHC, and for about 12 years. And for many of those years, Sheila was always mentioned and discussed as really the conscience for the extremely low income and their needs, and the homeless. And so I started paying attention, and I grew to admire her from afar. And I remember participating in an executive program for nonprofit leaders, executive directors, and so forth at the Kennedy School. And one of our professors was Bill Apgar. And Bill told this group of 50 leaders who were all involved in affordable housing at one point, if you don't know Sheila Crowley, you have to.
you must know this person, you must become a member of NLIC, and so forth. So a number of years later, I'm applying for the job at NLIC, and Sheila asked me, so why do you want to do this? And I talked to her about how many, many years ago I was involved in Peace Corps, focusing on extremely low-income people, working with extremely low-income in Guatemala and Paraguay and other places. And that the mission of NLIC was so important to me. It was my passion, my heart. But I also said, and frankly, Sheila, I just really would love working with you. And then she said, well, I have to tell you something. I'm going to be retiring in 2 years. So I said, well, oh, that's not so good. But I do want to just say something, two things. One is because I'm sort of the deputy and you know, have my one-on-ones with Sheila, and we discuss things about what's happening with the staff and, you know, that kind of thing. I want to say that her heart about the staff is phenomenal. She really, really cares. And that comes across every day in our work. And it's the reason that they love her. And they follow her and would follow her off the cliff. Fortunately, I haven't had to do that. But she is a true leader because of her passion, because of what she cares about, but also because she cares so deeply about the people who work for her. That's number one. Number two, the only people she cares about more than them, and her family, of course, are the homeless and extremely low-income residents. And that comes across so clearly in every meeting we have, every conversation we have. Bottom line, is it good for low-income, extremely low-income people, or isn't it? And that's our guiding light. And she's been our guiding light, and I just wanted to say something on behalf of the staff. Yeah. Sheila, we're going to really miss you.
Thanks. I think we have time for one more. I saw, oh, Christine's got the mic, so we'll try to do a few more. I want to give Sheila a chance to talk too. So go ahead, Christine.
Hi, I'm Christine Alamano. I have three strikes against me. I'm from Florida. I'm a legal services attorney, and I'm Italian. So it's very hard for me to contain my emotions. And a lot of things that happen in the housing arena, I'm just like. And one thing I learned from Sheila, Sheila's kind of a role model for me because she's always had this poker face. When Sheila's happy, she's. When Sheila's sad, she's. When Sheila's mad, she's. And whatever it is, she always has this very calm voice, and she backs it up with the data and the research. And I've tried to learn from her to, you know, sort of tone down my own personality, my own, you know, Italian genes, and go with that. And one thing that's very telling is even people who are not sympathetic to our cause, they respect the work that the coalition has done. That's a result of what Sheila has done. I have people tomorrow on lobby day who you would think not want to meet with me, who when I've said I'm from the National Low Income Housing Coalition, they're falling all over themselves to meet with me just because they respect Sheila and they respect the work that the coalition has done. So I'm going to try to go in there tomorrow with my poker face and maintain and just give them the data and give them the research. And, you know, thank you for being a role model for me. I've learned a lot from you about how to be a more effective advocate. And I'm going to miss you. Oh, one more thing. She went to Key West. We're Facebook friends. And she went to Key West this winter. And I'm like, oh, man, I would have loved to have seen that.
Scott?
Hi. I just wanted to say, when I first started working on the Hill, a gazillion years ago, I was interested in a lot of things, but I was drawn to housing for two specific things. One, I'm Scott Olson. Who cares? thank you.
We care, Scott.
For two specific reasons. One, is it is very tangible. The things you do help people in their lives, which I'm not sure I could ever figure out why things like trade and all these other things that I was working on did. So I was drawn to that. But two, more than putting someone in a home was all the incredible collateral benefits of giving people hope, giving people a chance to stabilize their lives, giving people a sense of pride, all the things that come with having a place to live. And so that's always given me a lot of joy in working on this issue. And what it really does is call attention to what is really lacking here tonight, is that it's great that all these people here that know Sheila are out here to pay her tribute. But in reality, in some sort of alternative universe, what we really ought to do is assemble the countless, untold, huge numbers of people whose lives you've affected, who don't even know that, the things you've fought for, the things you've won on, the things that have made a difference and provided housing for people. Somehow, in my fantasy, all these people would be here today and would understand that impact. And I realized that it was really not in your ability to do that. But that has really been the effect that we don't see. And so because of that, I, you know, pay tribute to you. It's been an honor to work with you, with the organization, with all of you for so long. And I kudos to you.
Barb Poppy, and I just want to, what? No, no more. We're not allowed to say that anymore, lest you know. I want to speak on behalf of all of us in the world who've really labored on behalf of people who experience homelessness. Because too often, there's been this disconnect between solving homelessness is really related to housing. And you never lost sight of that, even as you moved on from the Daily Planet and your daily interactions with folks. It stayed, I know, true in your heart. And it stayed just so clear and evident as to why you advocated for people to have access to housing. And so many of us who work on the issue of homelessness are ever grateful for the work that you've done on the behalf of the folks we advocate for, and for connecting the broader affordable housing movement to homelessness, and not leaving us kind of by the side of the curb as those folks who are somehow less deserving. So on behalf of all of us in this room and those beyond who've been a part of the movement, we are so grateful for your leadership at the coalition and for all of the ways that you raise up the really important place that we see, which is a home is how we end homelessness. Mm-hmm. And there is nothing else that makes more of a difference than that. So thank you, Sheila, for being our leader in those ways.
Rob, we'll let you have the last word before we let Sheila up. Whoops, sorry, we got, maybe almost last word.
Do I have to sing this? I met Sheila when she first started her job, and I thought it was a really hard act to follow, following Barry Zegas, who was dynamite. But Sheila, you've exceeded the great Barry Zegas in many ways. And I would say that even if Barry was here, but he's not. But Sheila doesn't really like California that much. And I work in rural California, and she doesn't know anything about rural housing. But we invited her out to our conference 5 or 6 times. And she told me the last time that we invited her to our conference more than any other group in the country, which made me very proud, and I sure has had nothing to do with the fact that our conference is on the beach. But she came out dutifully many times. The last time, unfortunately, I coupled her with John Taylor from the National Community Reinvestment Coalition, and she's never forgiven me for that. But Sheila, I must say that, you know, in all honesty, you are the most stubborn, the most passionate and caring affordable housing advocate I've ever met. And just look around this room and you see all the many faces, all the different kinds of people here. You have really achieved enormous things with the coalition. You should be very proud of what you've done, and I wish you the best in retirement.
Thanks, Rob. Sarah? Who's talking? Sarah?
Hi, yes.
I just want to say that when I first started the coalition 7 years ago as an intern, I wasn't sure how I would apply myself in life, and now I can say with so much certainty that I will always be dedicated to low-income housing, and that's thanks to Sheila. And I made a tough decision to leave her and the coalition and go to UC Berkeley. And I got there and they said, when you're here, what we're doing, what you're gonna learn how to do is how to speak truth to power. And I was like, I already know how to do that. And yeah, and I left and I was very excited to kind of develop my own policy voice, and I get asked as I make decisions and opinions, and I get asked what, you know, where do I see myself in 10 years? And, you know, Sheila is still in my head and my heart. And you've been my first boss, and you'll always be the boss. And you've been such a wonderful mentor, and I owe everything to you, so.
Thank you, Sarah. Here we go. Okay. You got the mic? Okay.
So.
And then I have Ann, too. Brenda, you're going to go next? Belinda, I'm sorry. I'm Brenda. Oh. I know that.
Well, I'll go ahead since I have
I'm sorry,
the mic.
Karen, we're not finished yet. Hold on.
Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead. You go.
Anybody who knows me knows this is not what I do, so I'm really nervous right now. But I feel compelled, you know, just to tell you that I love and appreciate you. I've known Sheila since I was 19, like she said earlier today. And so she knew me as a very, very young woman. I was still finding myself, and you've given me a lot of great opportunities to grow. You've been an amazing mentor. You've encouraged me and helped me through some very difficult times in my life, and have been very supportive. And you saw something in me when I, you know, didn't see it in myself. So I appreciate you for that. You've helped me grow into the woman that I've become. And I just want to say thank you. And this is very bittersweet for me. Bitter because I'm definitely going to miss you. But sweet for you because you get to retire. So I hope that we can continue to maintain our relationship. I really appreciate you. You've been like a second mom to me. So thank you. And I love you.
Linda?
Hi, my name is Belinda Mayo, and I'm from Philadelphia, and I'm going to try not to be emotional, but I had to come over here and stand by Bill. I began with the coalition at LIHEST in 1981. I lived in Philadelphia. I worked for a tenant organization and really grew up in this organization, learned about housing advocacy, learned what to say and what not to say, when to say it and when not to say it. And we found ourselves in a very peculiar place at the time that we brought Sheila on, and that we were changing the organization. We were becoming one organization. We had gone through several directors. Even Bill was our director for a while, going back and forth between Ohio and DC. And we just knew that we had to find leadership.
Somebody better than that.
No. This is my turn, Bill, be quiet. And so we were in a search process, and Bill talked about Sheila and how this would be a great opportunity for us, and we decided to interview Sheila. And one of the questions, and I've told Sheila this story over and over again, one of the questions that I asked Sheila was, what was her greatest accomplishment? And she thought, she was very thoughtful, and then she said, my children. And for me, as a single parent raising my children and looking back over at the sacrifices and the things that I needed to do in order to make a better life for them, it touched my heart in a very special way. And that sealed the deal for me. And Bill and I began a real struggle with the rest of the search committee to say, this is who. This is who.
Will you stop your interrupting?
This is who we need to come and take us to the next level. And it happened. We brought Sheila on. And at that time, I have to admit, I decided to go back to Philadelphia to focus on what we needed to do in Philadelphia with a strong foundation from the coalition. And I didn't come back. But 2 years ago, when the coalition was about to celebrate its 40th anniversary, Sheila reached out to me and said, I want you to come and talk to us about the early days. And I came to the conference. I was very emotional, in tears. I was on a panel with some ex-Republican HUD-type people. And I listened to what they were supporters, and I listened to what they had to say. And when it was my turn, I talked about how being here and being in this organization and passing on to Sheila the responsibility of taking the coalition to another level had made a big difference in my life. And so I thank you, Sheila, for bringing me back, for forcing me into the conversation that I didn't want to have about a number of different things, but saying that we're okay, we're doing well. And I think that while I don't know a lot of people in this room, and this is a different crowd, it's still a strong crowd, it's still a crowd of advocates, it's still people who care about housing, who care about poor people, and you have really provided the kind of leadership that they've needed in order to make the kind of changes that we made. And I'm very excited about Diane, very excited. And I just know that this coalition is gonna be okay, and when Bill goes back to Ohio and I go back to Philadelphia, it's gonna be okay. Thank you.
Thank you. One more comment, Anne.
Are we, oops, I guess we're not done, so I won't do what I was gonna do. I just wanna just give a toast to the most politically courageous woman I've ever met in my life. And I know she likes clear liquid, so find a clear liquid glass. And go as my grandchildren do, go clinky clinky. And welcome Diane and say thank you from the bottom of our hearts to Sheila.
Thank you. Thank you, Anne. I know there are others who still want to have comments, but at this time I'd like to call the wonderful Sheila Crawley up to the platform.
Thank you.
Well, I have no idea how to adequately respond to that outpouring of love, just to tell you that I feel it intensely and that I am humbled and grateful for your really genuine caring about me. And your caring about what we do, and your commitment to what is a just cause. This is my granddaughter Rebecca's first interaction with the National Low Income Housing Coalition. Stand up, Rebecca. I think she's got a flavor for us. What do you think? Anyway, so let me just say a couple of things about the indomitable Barney Frank. First thing is that Barney spoke at virtually every conference we had for many, many years. And when he even came in the door, people jumped up and gave him a standing ovation. He has always been the closest thing to a rock star in the low-income housing movement. And I just am so grateful that he came all the way from Maine to be here with us tonight. And of course, I am extraordinarily grateful for the great work that he has done on behalf of low-income people for many, many, many years in the Congress. And it is all well and good for us to say, well, we're great advocates and we do all this kind of stuff. But at the end of the day, what you need is a champion who can close the deal. And that's Barney. And Barney did that for us over and over and over again. We got a letter from Barney once after we had an ad, after we did something big with the trust fund, and we had an ad in Roll Call, and we got, I don't know, 2,000 signers on a letter to some senators around something, and Barney sent this. It is, you get letters from Barney in there, you know, two-sentence letters, and he says, I don't know if you remember this, he says, you know, you only compare to the NRA in your ability to generate grassroots and support. And we were very, very impressed with that. And we have that, Barney, no joke, that is framed and it's in our lobby, that letter. The other thing that Barney used to say is that in Washington there are a lot of horseless headmen, but that there were a few people who actually were riding a horse and making things happen, and we were part of that. So I'm going to tell you two other things about Barney Frank. One is, so there's this legend about us having these screaming battles, which Barney has perpetuated in his book about us. And I don't remember there being that many of them, but I do remember the intensity of one screaming battle. And I think it's because I screamed back at him. And we never really had another screaming battle after that. And it was really about sort of getting to know each other in the most important way as to why it is we were both there doing that work. And I was in tears, I'll tell you, I was in tears. Ask George Moses, I called him, I was in tears. But it was about trying to explain what it means to carry with you every day the enormous pain that somebody who doesn't have a place to go home to at night has, and the sense of responsibility that you have to do something about that. And I don't want to get weepy here, but I don't know why it happened to me, but I just have that pain. And it stays with me all the time, and I can remember vividly the names and the faces of the people that I know who didn't have a place to go home at night, and how wrong that was, and how ridiculous that was in a country like ours. And Barney and I figured out that we had that same intensity of feeling, and that's what made us be able to work so closely together. Sorry. I shouldn't have wine before I have to talk. The other thing I want to tell you about Barney, and this is, so talk about toasted marshmallows. You know, Barney's known as a great curmudgeon. But my mother, who is a great letter writer, read Barney's book, and Barney represented the district that my parents are from, Fitchburg, Massachusetts, for a while till he got redistricted. He took the place after Father Drynan was told by the Pope he couldn't continue to serve in Congress, and my parents were from Fitchburg, and my mother was a volunteer in Father Drynan's office. Anyway, and my mother's a political junkie, and she can tell you anything that's going on. But anyway, so she wrote Barney this note about his book. I don't know what the note said, but she wrote him a note about it, and my mother does that. Barney wrote her back. Barney Frank got this note from my mother and wrote her back, and she was so thrilled. And Barney introduced himself to my sister tonight as a correspondent with my mother. So, anyway, and I'm going to tell my mother that Barney said that, and it is going to make her year, Barney. You will not believe it. It'll be so great. It'll be so great. The other thing is that Barney welcomed me tonight by saying, well, here we are, the has-been caucus. So, and if Barney is in that caucus, it's really good company. So let me just say something quickly about retirement, because I don't want to weep anymore, but I want to say something quickly about retirement. See, when I decided to finally retire, I called every board member individually to tell them I was retiring, and they were like, oh my God, or, you know, anyway. And Bill Abgar said to me, well, that's good, you know, work sucks. He said, people keep sending me these papers about GSE reform and blah, 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 blah. And I kept cares? Anyway. Anyway, it provided me with an enormous sense of freedom about being able to do that. But anyway, I decided retirement is kind of cool. I realize we are shamelessly milking this, my retirement, for a very long time. I'm the only person who retired longer than I have was Sister Lillian, who, you know, she had parties all across the country. But anyway, it is something that I have figured out is really, it's an incredible luxury to be able to say that you can, in fact, do something else at this stage in your life. And I know that there's lots and lots of people who never get to do that. And so I'm very mindful of the privilege that it brings. I'm mindful that I am extremely fortunate to be married somebody who will make me happy every day, and even though we have spent our lives working we've never made a lot of money, but we have managed to be frugal enough to be able to retire with some comfort. And so then I get to, you know, decide what I want to do from here on out. And so I'm looking forward to some downtime. I'm looking forward to a lot of time with my beautiful daughters and my wonderful grandchildren, all of whom you saw this morning. There's six of them. To spending a lot more time with my husband and my sister and my mother, who's coming to spend time with us. And then figure out what I want to do. And see, the nice thing then is what people tell me is that when you retire, you only need to do things that you want to do. And so I'm going to pick and choose what it is that I want to do. Hopefully it will be a contribution that will continue to play some role in advancing our agenda. So Daisy and Martha and Dolores and Matt and all the other residents who have served on our board, thank you for keeping us grounded in what matters. Thank you for challenging us when we get off course. And thank you for the work that you do to make a difference in the lives of the people in your communities all the time. It is a unique feature of Washington organizations that the people who are affected by policy are at the table with us, and it's one of the things about the National Low Income Housing Coalition that I hold most dear. Final word, Diane Yentel is fabulous. I thought that before, but hanging out with her for a week before the forum, that has been affirmed. I think all of you who heard her speech this morning came away feeling really confident about where we're headed, and I am very, very happy to be handing over this great organization to somebody that I am so fond of and so have so much confidence in. Anyway, thank you all very, very much.
Thank you all, and thank you, Sheila, for those comments. I'm sorry not everybody got a chance to add their comments, but there'll be plenty of time to talk. Mr. Frank has agreed to some books, to sign some books, and I think we're in the right outside the door. So if you'd like to do that, please do, and please continue to enjoy the evening. Thanks again for all that you do.